And that's a quick check of what's happening in the business world. CBS.marketwatch.com for the rest of the day's action, and I'll see you guys in the next half hour.
All right. Thank you, Susan. It is just 2 minutes shy, well, now just 1 minute shy of 6 o'clock. Audrey Fuente is in for Dave Price. Mario Blasquez has the headlines, and we've got everything else covered for you this morning.
And Sean is taking the day off.
I wish. We'll do it all for you. I so wish. It's one of those days.
Yeah. Looks like we're getting some showers this morning already. We're going to look at them on our storm tracker radar, where we're picking up a batch of some strong showers or heavy showers coming through the Twin Forks of Long Island, heading right through Montauk. Those of you watching from that area, you can expect some brief downpours and maybe some occasional lightning, but these showers are moving quickly to the east at about 30 miles per hour, so they'll be moving out of the region pretty shortly. Everyone else is dry this morning, but later today we all have a chance of some showers. I'll tell you all about them in your full forecast coming up. You see right there, though, we have a temperature moving into the 80s later this afternoon. We're going to check traffic this morning, and for that we'll go over to Candy Roth, who's on the phone in for Vanessa.
All right. Good morning, Audrey. And we're going to take a live shot and see what's cooking. Let's peek in at those heading to the George Washington Bridge and crossing over the span. You can see lots of traffic, both upper and lower, and it's moving okay for now. There's just a minor delay at the toll. It's also just a minor delay at the Lincoln Tunnel and at the Holland Tunnel, just a minor delay, of course. Commercial traffic is still banned at that Manhattan-bound Holland Tunnel for heightened security reasons until further notice. As we switch over to the maps and we head up to the New England Thruway southbound, that right lane remains shut down right at exit 16 in New Rochelle. That is police activity that does impact your commute. Also, if you're traveling in New Jersey, still construction south on the Garden State Parkway from 129 to 125. You've got the three right lanes down until further notice. Street cleaning is in effect. Back to you, the studio.
All right. Thank you very much, Candy. We begin this hour with a CBS 2 exclusive about a man who says he dated Governor Jim McGreevy's alleged lover. He claims to know the truth about Golan Sipple's sexuality and the true nature of the governor's relationship with him. Jay Dow has more from Livingston. And Jay Dow will have that report for us later this morning here on CBS 2 News This Morning. And we'll be following this story and all the latest developments. Also coming up in just moments, we'll have a statement, today's statement released from Israel from Golan Sipple. So stand by for that on this still developing story. Meantime, Golan Sipple is trying to keep quiet this morning while staying with family in Israel. Thousands of miles away in a Tel Aviv suburb, Sipple had nothing to say to our Andrew Kurtzman. The former press aide is despondent, according to people who know him there. A former supervisor of Sipple's here in New York is concerned.
We will understand is that if it is true that he's not homosexual, as he claims, if it is true that he was sexually harassed, why on earth did he wait for 4 years? I mean, it doesn't make any sense.
Well, Sipple maintains he is heterosexual, denies Governor McGreevy's claim they had a consensual relationship. Now, that statement we mentioned to you moments ago was released from Israel, saying in part, quote, "I assume that every few days a new lie will come up worse than its predecessor. Lies and manipulations offered, operated by the governor and his lawyers and advisors who have unlimited financial resources, all to threaten me and to silence me." Now to that exclusive we told you about, brought to you from by Jay Dow. Now the story comes your way from Livingston, again about a person who alleges to have known Golan Sipple. Here's that story now.
He claims he is the man that knows Golan Sipple's true sexuality. Dr. David Miller, a 52-year-old emergency physician who did not want a camera in his home for most of our two-hour interview. But Miller spoke at length about his belief that someone persuaded Sipple to accuse Governor James McGreevy of sexual harassment. Miller told us he's been romantically involved with Sipple during two separate time periods over the last 5 or 6 years, but insists they always remained friends. The first time, for a few months before he says Sipple became romantically involved with Governor James McGreevy, and around the time Sipple joined his administration as a Homeland Security advisor. Miller told us, quote, "Golan was Jimmy's lover," referring to the governor, and, quote, "they were in a happy relationship." But Miller made it a point to note that although, quote, "he's charming, attractive, and sexy, and pleasant to be around," Miller says he always felt as though Sipple thought and spoke too much about money, and that in his words, Golan isn't the most honest person in the world. Miller went on to say that, quote, "after Jim broke up with Golan, Golan began acting like a jilted lover." As for the governor, Miller says that he was openly gay only to a small group of friends, and he rejects recent reports that his wife Dina never knew he was gay, telling us, quote, Dina knew all along. Dina thought she could change him. And when the governor finally came out to the world last week, Miller, who after some 17 years of marriage came out to his own wife, told us he said to himself, quote, good for him. We made repeated calls to Sipple's attorney in New York. We have yet to hear back from him. We also reached out to the governor's office, Press Secretary Mike Erasmussen, telling us that when he hears the governor's wife say that she just found out that the governor was gay, he has to believe her. And regarding the governor's recent acknowledgement that he is gay, Mike Erasmussen says that the governor has been through a difficult period over the last 3.5 weeks, doing a lot of soul searching. And when he hears the governor say that he just came to this conclusion himself, Erasmussen says he has to believe the governor as well. As for David Miller, he says he's off to Israel and would not rule out reaching out to Golan Sipple. In Livingston, New Jersey, Jay Dow, CBS 2 News.
All right, thank you, Jay. Time now is 6:04, and we want to mention there are also some new developments in the political landscape surrounding McGreevy's resignation. Among them, Senator John Corzine speaking out for the first time about a special election. McGee Hickey is live outside Corzine's office in Newark with the very latest. Good morning, McGee.
Good morning to you, Sean. Well, the political maneuvering in New Jersey just gets more and more intense. Now, Senator John Corzine is saying he doesn't want to be the one to push Governor McGreevy out of office, but he is leaving the door open, saying if someone else does the pushing, he might be interested in running for governor if there is a special election. Add to that another drama going on, the Congressman Menendez affair.
Democrats.
Senator John Corzine says he's not running for New Jersey governor, at least not for the time being. Governor McGreevy made clear in our conversation his absolute intent to serve until November 15, 2004. I accept that decision as final. He added, I will continue to work for the election of a Democratic majority in the Senate and the election of John Kerry to the White House. But that hardly means New Jersey's Democratic Party is accepting the governor's decision to stay on. Congressman Robert Menendez is calling on McGreevy to step down immediately, while a source in McGreevy's office says Menendez is having an affair of his own. Quote, how hypocritical it is for the congressman to call for the governor's immediate resignation over an illicit affair when the congressman had an illicit affair and then set her up in business, which he then referred clients to. Maybe it's the congressman who should be resigning. Also yesterday, McGreevy's top fundraiser, Charles Kushner, the man who helped bring Golan Sipple to America, pleaded guilty to 18 federal counts, including witness tampering and campaign finance violations. And a spokesman for Congressman Menendez says the congressman has shown no favoritism towards the woman's company, saying, quote, he is as helpful to that firm as he is to any other. We're live in Newark. McGee Hickey, CBS 2 News. Back to you, Sean and Mario.
McGee, thank you. CBS 2 will follow every development in this story, and as we mentioned, we'll bring you updates as they happen. Sean.
All right. Thank you, Mario. Time now is 6:07 this morning. Iraqi captors vowing to kill an American journalist from our area if U.S. troops don't pull out of Najaf. CBS 2's Reed Lamberty is live in Greenwich Village with more on the story. Good morning, Reed.
Sean, the hostage takers issued a very grim threat last night and gave a deadline of 48 hours. The pan-Arab television station Al Jazeera aired the video of the man being held hostage, the man who lives in this Greenwich Village apartment building, sending a jolt of fear through family and friends.
It is a sight with which we've grown uncomfortably familiar. Rifles and rocket-propelled grenades held by masked men surrounding a kneeling American hostage. A militant group calling itself the Martyrs Brigade said it will kill 36-year-old Mike Guerin if U.S. forces do not pull out of Najaf. Guerin, a journalist who lives in Greenwich Village and works for Four Corners Media out of New York, was kidnapped Friday from this marketplace in Nasiriyah while photographing a report on archaeological looting. Eyewitnesses tell CBS 2 News armed men in civilian clothes grabbed him, dragged him into a car, and beat him. The militant group is linked to radical Shiite cleric Muqtada al-Sadr. It wants the U.S. to leave the holy city of Najaf. Here in Greenwich Village, friends and family gathered inside Guerin's apartment. Authorities did meet with the family last night, but no new information developed.
Last week, when Shiite Muslims kidnapped a British journalist and held him hostage, aides to radical cleric Muqtada al-Sadr condemned the move, and that man was later released. It appears at this point that is not the case for Micah Guerin. Live in Greenwich Village, Reed Lamberty, CBS 2 News this morning. Mario, Sean.
Thank you, Reed. And radical cleric Muqtada al-Sadr has accepted a peace plan to disarm his militia and leave an important shrine in Najaf. But this morning, an Iraqi cabinet minister says Iraqi forces could begin an offensive against the cleric within hours, despite the ceasefire proposal. But in the meantime, gunfire and explosions continue to rock the holy city, just as the deal was announced yesterday. The Bush administration says actions speak louder than words, and al-Sadr needs to, quote, match words with deeds. A senior Pentagon official says the investigation into prisoner abuse at Abu Ghraib prison is expected to blame 24 people. The New York Times is reporting that an investigation found senior U.S. commanders created conditions that allowed the abuse to occur because they failed to provide leadership and sufficient resources. The report is expected to be delivered to Congress next week.
Here in the U.S., from looting to health hazards, the aftermath of Hurricane Charley in Florida, it just keeps getting worse. Residents of Sanibel Island returned home yesterday for the first time since last week's storm, but some people found their homes destroyed or looted. Yeah. Meanwhile, officials are asking residents to get tetanus shots to ward off a potential health hazard. And a MASH unit, it's working long hours, treating a growing number of injuries.
Charley's even getting worse now because people are going to make mistakes they normally wouldn't make.
22 people were killed by Hurricane Charley, and almost 500,000, they are still without power. A disaster relief fund has been created to help the victims. So far, it has received more than $1 million in donations.
All right. Time now is 6:10. This is one of those days where just a can of hairspray is not going to help you. It is humid outside. At least it is to me.
Hairspray alert.
Definitely. Ponytail alert.
We also have a birthday alert. We have,
oh, really?
Yeah, on your email, we got two birthdays. We want to celebrate our 38th birthday with Mark Mullen. I know it might be a little late. I know he watches right around 6 a.m. I don't know if he's missed him already.
Watching.
You think so? And one-year-old, Kevante.
Hey.
Kevante's one?
Yeah.
That's a special time.
Yeah, that
happy
is,
birthday.
Because when the twos come, I feel sorry for his parents. They can be terrible sometimes.
All right, well, good to see you up and paying attention, Sean.
I get paid to do this sometimes.
We thought we'd help you wake up a little bit. We're a little outcast for you because we know that gets Sean going, and she needs a little energy, but she hasn't had her coffee this morning. Let's take a look outside, though, folks. Pretty muggy out there. Temperatures are warm. We're mostly in the 60s and 70s, but we have a lot of humidity building in the area, and that's going to make for a very sticky Thursday throughout the tri-state region. Temperatures right now are mostly in the 70s, and we have 73 degrees right now in Central Park. The humidity quite high at 93%. The barometer steady in the winds. They're coming out of the southwest right now. Area-wide, the temperatures are mostly in the 70s. We're at 70 in Beacon, 71 in Dover. It's 73 in Bridgeport, as well as Westbury, and even out towards Center Reach. We did have a few showers across the Twin Forks of Long Island this morning, still lingering around the Montauk, and they are moving quickly to the east, so you should be drying out over the next hour. Clouds are thickening up towards our west. We have a cold front bringing some showers into western parts of Pennsylvania this morning, and these will slowly progress eastward. We have a lot of humidity building around the region, and that in conjunction with this front coming from the west will help spark off some showers and thunderstorms later this afternoon. So grab that umbrella on the way out the door. You'll probably need it later today. More of the same as we go into Thursday. It will continue to be warm and humid, and again, we'll have those thunderstorms developing in the afternoon as this front stalls just towards our north. We really won't get into as much drier as we go in until we get into about Sunday. That's when we'll really dry out and become much more comfortable as this area of high pressure comes in from the west. We'll be humid for the start of the weekend, but the second half of the weekend looks much more comfortable. The winds will come out of the north, dry us out, and it will be less humid and cooler with highs into the mid to upper 70s. For today, though, our high temperatures will be into the 80s. We're expecting 84 right here in New York City. Then for tonight, we'll have a few showers lingering, and our overnight low should drop back to about 70 degrees. Scattered storms later this afternoon, so you want to keep that umbrella handy. Then as we look into the next 5 days, looking pretty good as we go into Sunday. Until then, it will be quite warm and humid as we take a look at the five-day forecast.
Mario promised to work out with me this morning.
Is this getting you moving, Sean?
Work out a way to have breakfast later.
Our showers and storms later this afternoon today.
Is that what that is?
Well, you know what? Even when you're at your desk, you can still work out. Get your arms in shape.
I feel like I'm a Muppet or something.
Come on. How many calories are you burning with that?
Probably about 900.
Well, can I have my arm back? Would you mind? Thank you.
Now he's got rhythm.
Sean is a